Yesterday, we heard about child prodigies, and we also heard this morning about the enterprising Bharatanatyam dancers who were quick to put their brand up right after their performance. Here we have Vishal Gondal. Vishal started his entrepreneurial journey at the age of 16, and he founded India Games, one of the very, very first ventures in the gaming. And at the age of 16 or 17, he was already a father of Indian gaming industry. Having taken this company to amazing heights, he exited in the year 2012 by selling this to none other than Walt Disney. Post that, he served with them as their chief digital officer with Disney UTV. He has also been a very notable angel investor. He routinely invests in very interesting ventures, and one of the challenges, he says, is to find the right companies to invest. So I hope Vishal's journey here would help him get to a few more of those. He was listed among the top 50 executives in the mobile content space by the UK-based mobile entertainment magazine alongside noted people like Steve Jobs. He enjoys outdoors, running marathons, ultras, trekking, skydiving, you name it. His love for outdoors and pushing himself physically dates to his growing years when he was a national level volleyball player. Vishal is a longtime tedster, gadget and gizmo freak, and a judge on two television shows, The Pitch on Bloomberg and Your Wish Is My App on NDTV. His passion for technology, fitness, and gaming has led him to his next venture, Goki. Goki is focused on people helping people make a change towards a healthier lifestyle and be the force of good. In March 2014, Vishal launched Goki. He's currently this company is headquartered in Menlo Park, California, and lists marquee investors and market here in India. He's currently the founder and CEO of Goki and works out of his Mumbai office. The session that he's going to do with us today, which is the 12 Surya Namaskars of marketing, is really the Bible for anybody who wants to have a playbook for B2C consumer marketing. He did this session for 2 hours in the recent TIECON Bombay, and it was voted the best session. We only have half an hour of his time to do this session with us today. So I hope that we are able to grab every nugget of what he's going to share with us today and enjoy the session too. With this, I'd like to welcome Vishal.
Thanks a lot, Vishwas.
Hang around.
It's fine. I think we don't have much time, as Vishwas already told you. It's a 2-hour session, which I'm going to try and rush through in 30 to 40 minutes. Is there a clicker or something for my slides? Do we have something to? Oh, I have to keep telling them. Okay, that's a good one. So I think first of all, really, really happy to be here. I consider Pune very much part of the city where I live, Mumbai, because at times it is faster to reach Pune than to reach Borivali or South Bombay. So Pune is actually literally the backyard. But I think today one of the reasons I wanted to be here and to talk about the whole paradigm of marketing, especially in the consumer space, is because we are right now looking at companies going out of money. You know, there's talks of, you know, companies who have blown up so much money on TV advertising, print advertising, still not being able to get consumers to stick. And I think in that context, the whole paradigm of how do you acquire customers is very key, which is why when I wanted to title the session, the Surya Namaskars, it was another way to get people's attention. While we actually made people do Surya Namaskars, we're not going to do here in Pune. I know a lot of Punekers are already very fit. But the question really is that just like how Surya Namaskar is a very, very basic thing anybody can do to remain healthier, there are certain fundamentals of what can be done from a consumer perspective. And I'm going to give you my experience when it, in the context of Gokhi and what we've been able to do. Sorry, how do I tell you to change the slide? There's no way to do it from here. So I think the question really goes back to having a crazy idea. And do we have a clicker at all, or we don't? Okay, you're getting one. Of having a crazy idea. And I think especially in a city like Pune, which does so much of manufacturing, I think way back in 2014, when we decided that we are going to get into the wearable space, it sounded like a very, very crazy idea. We have no experience of building hardware in our life, and we were up in competing with people like Fitbit, Apple, and all the other giants in the world who have been focusing in the wearable space. But do we add the clicker? But coming back to this crazy idea of wearables, as you know, and in fact, we just heard about data and how data is important. In my own experience, what I saw was, in the case of health, while data is important, nobody does anything with the data. Everybody knows that they should be eating healthy, you know, not eating fried food, not smoking, and all of that, but still people end up doing it. So in my own case, while I was a national level volleyball player in school, I had almost become a volleyball running my own games company. And when I decided to change my own lifestyle, I bought all the apps. I got the app, you know, the Fitbit and Jawbone and everything. I happened to use them for 15 days, 20 days, but the whole idea never used to work, and I used to stop. And I think that's when we got the core insight. And I'll be talking about how we went about taking it to the next level. So today, just to give you an interesting number, we are already the number one wearable player in this country, launching and competing with pretty much all the big guys here. And the best part of this slide is we do not even compete with them. In our minds, we are actually not competing with Fitbit or Xiaomi or Apple or any of these people. The reason being that we never launched a consumer hardware business. What we launched was a service business. Hardware was just the means to the end. And I think that was the game changer when it came to addressing a consumer need. And in my own case, what I realized was that data was of no use, but that data going to an expert like a fitness coach or a health coach, looking at that data and then telling me what to do. And in a way, motivating me to make those changes is what led to this. So the crazy idea of saying we are going to compete with all these people and now saying that we are already number one is a very, very different context. And this didn't happen by us spending more on marketing or us spending more on design. In fact, I don't even claim that we have the best hardware. You know, we are comparable, we are equal. Maybe Fitbit and other people have better hardware in certain cases, but still more consumers are opting for what Gokey is doing as a service. And I think that comes with, first of all, getting some key consumer insights and hopefully the clicker. So one of the key things, and if you look over here, the reason we really got to these kind of numbers is because 70% of our consumers came back to us because of referral, because they saw the benefit and they talked about Gokey to their friends. I don't know how many of you have used Gokey in this room so far. Yeah, there have been quite a few people, right? And the question really which we go back to is, all these people are literally brand ambassadors for us. And that's where we looked at our model and then we went ahead, and I'll talk a little bit about it. So when I talk about, again, the Surya Namaskars, as you know, it is very simple, 12 steps, you do it every day. But when it comes to brand marketing, it is as simple as this. And my idea was to break down some of these rules on what we did to get where we are. And by the way, this is just the beginning. We have not even started, and we are already leaders in the market. I think once we look at some of the new things we are going to be rolling out today, you will see why the approach has been very, very different. So the core of what we do, and the core of, if you are a consumer brand, if you are talking to the consumer, has to be this chart. This chart talks about one big thing, which is word of mouth. And if you are able to put together your strategy with the core of what can you do to generate word of mouth as the center of your offering, that is what gets you the virality. And if you look at what we did, and again, you know, we can go on to this complexity and so on, but the question really is that every piece of communication you do, every time you talk to the brand, there needs to be stories. And I think these stories are what go on. For example, in the case of Gokey, we have this whole concept of karma points. Every time you walk 390 steps, we give you one karma point. And these karma points are points which you have to donate to charity so that you become a good person and better than yourself. Now, do you know why this 390 steps? Why did we choose it to be 390 steps? Can anybody guess? Why not 400? Why not 1,000? Why not 10? Why 390? What algorithm could we be using? I know you can Google and find that answer too. So the simple answer is, it's because Mahatma Gandhi had walked 390 kilometers when they were doing the Dandi March. And we said, if 390 kilometers was walked to get a revolution, every 390 steps of yours equals to one of those points. Now this suddenly has become into a word of mouth story. This is something which, what happens is, when our users find out, because they ask us this question, that what is 390, who has calculated it, how is it done? And our answer is not that this is some algorithm which is patented by this university, versus saying that this is a story. And I think that's when the brands start coming in. when it's all about the stories. It's all about the secret formula which goes inside Coke. Of course, we don't want you to drink Coke, even though there is a secret formula in there. But the question really is that if you start centering your brand and your messaging around word of mouth, it changes. And again, there are opinion leaders, there is direct contact, there is media, there is events, there is a whole lot of things. But the center measurement has to be around word of mouth. And I think the other key thing is about identifying your key audiences. And I want to give you three examples of it. I think one thing which shocks a lot of people, once again, we entered the market with a hardware-based offering, but we are not available on even one store. We never ever went offline. And people are like, why are you stupid? Why are you not selling on Chroma? Why are you not on Reliance Digital? Why are you not on all these stores? Nobody is going to buy a product unless they physically see it. That's the conventional wisdom. But we realized one very simple thing, that we are a service which is virtual, a service where you are going to experience it on our app. You'll be talking to our coaches. So if you as a user cannot buy online, you are not our consumer. So it was actually counterintuitive of going back and saying, who is my consumer, and then targeting them rather than going wide and everywhere. And I think this is one big mistake which brands do, where they try to make their product available in many, many places without even understanding that whether your customer is really going to be there. So in our case, we were very clear that if you buy online, that is the first criteria of you being our customer. If you are telling me that you want to see the product and get a demo, then you might as well not get the product itself. Another example of the right identification goes back to the fact that we have been able to segment our users very, very carefully. For example, a lot of people assume that Gokey users are the ones who are running marathons and who are the ones who are fit and who are the ones who are doing all kinds of exercises when you look in Pune and other places. The reality is our users are not them. Our users, 99% of our users are couch potatoes. They are the guys who want to get healthy, who want to get fit. And once again, a lot of people assume the wrong target audience is start designing their product for somebody who's running a marathon or somebody who's trying to, get six packs. Their requirement is very different, and a fitness tracker may not be able to suffice them at all because they are already much ahead of that. So a lot of times, and I meet so many companies and startups who come with products without targetly identifying who their audience is, which creates the whole problem. The other very, very important thing is getting the strategic context. And again, an example of the strategic context was, it comes from the brand, what's happening in the society itself. And as you know, today, while India started in a very, very different context, from 1947 to liberalization in 1991, but now it's a very different India. It's no longer, people are no longer starving to death, people are eating too much. The problems are very different. So the society context is very different. The second very key thing about India was, in India, food is a means of celebration. You know, mu mitha karlo is a good thing, And here in a country, we cannot tell people don't do this. It was about telling them, how do you replace and change their habits to the better? And finally, I think the biggest insight, which once again worked very well for us, is India is not DIY. So I'm sure, in America, everybody goes to IKEA, buys furniture, and then comes home and puts it together. Very common thing. Similarly, in the US, US or wherever else in the West, people are used to following guides and to-do steps and everything. In India, nobody does it. In fact, we have people who are operating lifts and there is a person sitting inside. So once again, in the health context, we realized that just giving somebody a tracker and telling them here are the 20 steps and here is your plan and here is your exercise regime is not going to make a difference. So if you looked at this context and if you're trying to design a product, it is very different than just taking a brand from US or anywhere else and just plugging it into India. And I think this was one very important thing. And the reason I'm telling you this is a lot of times, if you don't get this right from a context perspective and you just start marketing, you will get consumers in the beginning, but these are not the consumers who are going to stay for long. So if you look at all the other brands who have come, Fitbit and all of them, they have just come with their same American playbook and they've started kind of selling this in the country. While there will be a set of people who will buy it, but it is certainly not going to attract a ton of people because the strategic context is very different. And here is an example for that. Another very important thing is looking through the consumer's eye. And here is another time we did. In fact, this was a study we focused on even before the launch to figure out what is the consumer looking for. And once again, I think, unfortunately, a lot of people don't spend enough time thinking about it and just think that, you know, I just need a model in my TV ad and I need a discount and people will come. But from a strategic context, we understood four things. The first thing was fitness and health currently is difficult. People are told that for weeks you're only supposed to eat boiled vegetables and, you know, eat all kinds of karela juice and God knows what. But the key thing was what people wanted was something fun, interesting and engaging. The current diet plans and all of those things were just too hard for normal people to follow. The second context which we got was what people were looking was for motivation and inspiration. They were not self-motivated. While most of the other platforms were focused on their self-motivation, that just because you have this app or just because you have this hardware, you're going to do this. The third thing was it should be easy, doable, and gradual. Once again, people are not saying that from tomorrow you're going to do 50 push-ups and 100 jumps and start walking 10,000 steps. It has to be gradual. So one of the key things, for example, we do is when you come onto our Gokey platform, our coaches will never tell you to do 10,000 steps from the first day itself. They will first figure out what level you are at. So if you're only walking 2,000 steps, they will push you to 5,000 and then push you to 8,000. What normally people do is they buy a Fitbit and say 10,000. And invariably, the 2,000 guy will never be able to do 10,000 and they drop off. So this was very important. And lastly, the thing about I wanted somebody who is concerned about me. And I think this again comes from a different model. The hardware business is, I sold you the dabba, now it's your problem. My job is over after we sell you the device. Only come to me if you have a problem in the hardware. That is the approach of the traditional hardware stroke device companies. While our model was completely the opposite. Our model actually starts from the day you activate the device because we decided to be a subscription service. So our entire model was not centered around selling the hardware, but actually giving you a service which you use and continue to be on our platform. So it was centered around this. And this insights is what we got from the consumers. And it was not very difficult. We didn't spend crores to do it. All we needed was four interns who interviewed many, many people from different things. So they actually had forms where they asked them these questions, what have you done? Everybody they knew had joined the gym, left the gym. Everybody they knew had bought some of those sauna belts and all these products which come on TV and some ring and, you know, all kinds of. So everybody has tried all of this and they kept failing. And these were the insights we got from them, which was kind of interesting. But the other thing which was also interesting for us to find before we even started our marketing plan, that what are we replacing? Today, if you cannot feed a need, as we say, you cannot be creating a product which can be a core product. For example, let's look at Uber and Ola. What they have done is they have almost, once you use Uber and Ola, you almost replace the need of actually booking a taxi or hailing a taxi anymore, because you are now going to the convenience of their app. Similarly, Paytm has been able to do that with cash or the whole wallet transactions. Amazon has been able to do that with shopping. So what we saw was that if you look at what is really happening, there are two kinds of mindsets which needs to be changed. One is the physical mindset, which leads to what is called a habit change. And then there is the initial change. And in our case, what we saw was the first thing which we were replacing was the watch. So I don't know how many of you are Gokey users here. Anybody still wearing a Gokey here? Not yeah, okay. So do you wear a watch anymore? Since when did you wearing a watch? 6 months. So that is the first thing. That anybody who comes onto the Gokey, the first thing we replace is the watch. You do not feel the need of wearing a watch anymore. But more importantly, it is no longer the watch. What we wanted to go after was replacing laziness. And this was once again the insight we got, that the question is that in their minds, can we make a person feel they have become more active? And I'm sure, do you think you're more active? No, I'm sure you're going to say yes. Okay, so the bigger question is, have you renewed your subscription yet? No, I mean, we'd love to know it. Sorry? Next month, okay. So the good thing is, and just to give you a number here, 70% of our active users renew their subscriptions. And the reason they do that is because they go through this entire thing, from first not being wanting a watch to being active and eating right, developing trust. So today what has happened is they have so much trust in Gokey that people actually call us to know if they are planning a holiday, mein kya khaun. In fact, I'll talk to you about another aspect of health where we have now got doctors and other people on our platform. But the question really is that once we figured out that we were actually not in the business of fitness trackers or coaching or anything else, we were in the business of replacing laziness in people's mind, and I know everybody has this problem, I think that kind of became the game changer. So all our communication centers around how do we replace laziness in the minds of people. Again, this was important. And finally, it came up to understanding yourself as a brand. What do we represent? So I'm sure, can anybody guess who that character is? Sound of Music. That's Mary. So as a brand, we said that we want to be this character in your life. So what happens is, and once again, you know, as you start using brands, you start associating brands with a character in your life. And every brand can do that. So what character do you think Apple would represent in your life? What character? It's not Steve Jobs. But the most common character, by the way, with Apple is a monk. They think that when you have Apple, the whole thing is around Dalai Lama, for example, like a monk who's there. Or for example, if you look at, let's say, a brand like Amazon. Who comes to your mind? Or WhatsApp? Think about it, because these associations are made. So in our case, we said that first of all, Gokey is a feminine brand. So when you think of Gokey, it was not about a male brand, it was a female brand. And by the way, just to give you another insight, 98% of our coaches are women. 98%. And it was clearly a female representative brand. And the qualities we wanted to imbibe in the brand was free-spirited, mischievous, fun personified, compassionate, authority, influential, takes you along. So this was not a strict teacher who's going to give you a chadi and say, do this from tomorrow. And we could have that method also, but we never went after that. For example, we never advertised Gokey as a diet solution or weight loss solution, because we believe that that is a completely different mindset, and that requires the chadi mindset, which doesn't work. In fact, the other interesting thing around that mindset is 98% people fail when they try to do weight loss programs. So if we are promising somebody weight loss, we are having 98% people who are going to fail, and the 2% who will be successful will never come back to you because they've already lost the weight. So it's a proposition where 100% of your customers will never come back. So in the case of Gokey, we said we are replacing happiness. We are making you, so if you look at our tagline is be the force. So we are not even, we are saying you can probably get weight loss, you can become active, you can become healthy, but more thing is we are going to replace laziness in your life and make you better and better and better. So the concept of weight loss, which unfortunately a lot of people who enter this space try and immediately target, is actually very, very counterintuitive when it comes to the product. So once again, this is a very complex slide, but I'll try and run you through it in a little more detail. So what we literally did was, we said you have to craft the communication as how you want to perceive it, and then how does your consumer perceive it. And this was, by the way, done with the combination of surveys, physical meetups. We are completely obsessed with our customer. And I think another company which you know does that very well is Amazon, where they only think about what the consumer cares about. They are not really worried about competition. And this is exactly what I did. So what we'll do is I'll just run this a little faster. But just to kind of, again, we will not have enough time to go through this in detail, but just to kind of give you a context of what we happen to do here, is we said that how do we physically communicate what we are doing? So one of the challenge of Gokey was, and again, thanks to the band, we were able to solve it. If we were just trying to communicate that we are a service which will give you a health coach, a doctor, and all these services, people are not able to imagine it because we are still very early days. Think of it like the early days of mobile phone, when if the mobile operator just said, here is a SIM card, people did not know what to do. So what happened in the early days were operators were bundling the phone and the SIM and selling you. Today we have reached a stage where people can buy their own phones and we are just selling you the service, the mobile operator. So we believe health is also in a similar, especially digital health, where consumers are unable to visualize what they want. So what we did was, we said the physical appearance of Gokey will be a coach, a fitness band, contemporary, fun, tech savvy, and it has a healthy aura. So all our communication, you will never see Gokey just advertising our hardware. It will always be the hardware with the coach and the whole service element built in, because that's how, so it's almost like a Trojan horse. So when you get the hardware, it actually opens up these services to you. So you never knew that you actually had the service in the first place. The personality which we wanted to do was approachable, free-spirited, the same personality of Mary as you saw. And we of course had the cultural context and the relationship context. I think the more important from a relationship perspective for us was the person needs to perceive Gokhi as their family. And another interesting insight for you that most users on their own referred to themselves as part of being part of the Gokhi family. Even though we never told them that, but they automatically become part of the family. And the reason was the reflection that how are they receiving this communication. And this was again done by studying what we are showing them some communication, and then we are figuring out what are they receiving from their end. So the receiving was amazing. So they did receive it as sporty, youthful, active and fit, very important. And their self-image of whoever used Gokhi was again very different. They were health conscious, active, enthusiast, experimenter, and self-belief. So once again, the question really was that whatever we are trying to communicate, are people perceiving it in the same way? And there is a huge mismatch once again for a lot of brands here, because they are not trying to even think of this as a communication message. So in our case, culturally, what we wanted to do was focus on social, which was very important. But one other thing was we had taken karma as a very important landmark of our strategy. In fact, like a lot of people promise when you go to a brand, they always try and make you a promise. Amazon will say that we will get you the best price, or Flipkart has something, or Uber has something. So our promise was about be the force, which is we are going to make you become a good person. And I think that was the very, very different positioning we had to take, because if you start believing that you are becoming a good person by being on Gokhi, that becomes a much longer relationship method for us versus having something which is tangible. So this was a big intangible which we were going to deliver. And there's actually a video here. We don't have time for that, so I'll just skip it. But the question really is that the video is playing. Sorry. So the video actually talks about, maybe I can just show you a couple of minutes of the video. You can go online and see this video. This video is from a TED speaker, which says how to start a movement. Derek Sivers. Are we back? Sorry. So I'll just show you 2 minutes of, like 1 minute of this video, so that you get the video and you can see it online. But I think the question really is that today, people are not just consuming brands, they are becoming part of something bigger than themselves. And I think Apple did it really well, and a lot of other brands are doing it. Like Paytm, for example, is telling you that when you use Paytm, you are becoming part of the digital payment revolution, and you are killing, in fact, Vijay keeps talking about that you are killing corruption, and you are killing black money. So it is not about just using Paytm, it's about entering the next era. It is about making India and leapfrogging that. So the whole communication is around that. Can we just play this video for a second?
Gentlemen, at TED, we talk a lot about leadership and how to make a movement. So let's watch a movement happen, start to finish, in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons from it. First, of course, you know, a leader needs the guts to stand out and be ridiculed.
It's not playing. So anyway, so I think What he's doing the video is so how easy. To start a movement by Derek Sivers, but crucial role.
He's going to show everyone else how to follow.
Sorry, this is.
Now notice
just go to the next slide. I don't
think
he's speaking well.
So now it's not about the leader anymore. It's about them.
Yep. So I think the question really was that how do you start a revolution? And how do you start a movement? And I think the key question which Derek Sivers will talk to you about in that video and what I want to talk about, it's about literally identifying your 1,000 true fans. So there is actually a book by Kevin Kelly which talks about that if you can get 1,000 people to believe in your product, your plan, that is what starts the revolution. That's what kickstarts the whole process. And what we did was exactly that. In 2014, we actually launched a beta program. And we said, we are going to be only selling 1,000 GoKis, the whole service. And we'll be only selling 1,000 GoKis, and people had to apply to become part of it. I know Vishwas was one of them, right? The early beta user. And the early beta users waited for 3 to 4 months to get the product. They paid almost 8,000, I mean, much higher price also. But what happened was these 1,000 people were the first believers of our concept. And they said, we are here to support you. So this is in a way what crowdfunding is now doing, but this was way before that, where these 1,000 people came on board and we started engaging with them because they not only became our early users, but they became almost like founders of the company. We spoke to them, we talked to them. In fact, I can now count a lot of these users as my friends, and we'll talk about that later. But the question really being that you first identify these users and go after them. It's not about launching your product and then figuring out how do I sign up 1 million users. The first thing is how do you get the first 1,000 users who can swear by your product. And I think that's when the whole thing starts. The second thing was in today's world, it's about being not the CEO, but being the chief customer officer. I think the world has changed where consumers no longer are dealing with the old way of customer service, where customer service started right at the bottom and then escalations went all the way up. So when, as a CEO, when something came to you, it means it was really bad. What we did was, in fact, me, my other senior members of our team, we ourselves address most of the social media queries when it comes, whether it is Twitter, whether it is Facebook. And the reason we did that was because today consumers have trust when they know who's talking, they know who's responding. And I'm sure you have seen and yourself experienced when you try and tweet to Vodafone or Airtel or any of these companies, they really, really don't get it right because the people there are not empowered. They don't know, they have no idea that a new plan has already been launched. By the time it percolates and reaches the customer service agent, it's too late. But in today's dynamic world, it was all about being the front, leading from the front, right from customer service. In fact, you know, if you try and tweet or have an issue on GoKi on Twitter, there is a big chance that me or somebody from my senior team will be responding to you. We do have customer service, but they are for regular social media campaigns and stuff like that. But we really took this very, very seriously. But what happened with this also is that we were able to solve a lot of our bigger problems much earlier. What happens is, and I'm sure since you're all entrepreneurs, you know that people under you will always try and put things under the carpet. So they will not even try and escalate these things to you unless they become really big. And I think bad news should reach first, then last. And I think this is one way where bad news came to us much earlier, because we knew what was happening with the consumers. We also said, I talked about making our first customers your best friend. And this is exactly what happened. These first users, for example, the gentleman on the left is Kamal Karnatak. Kamal Karnatak, by the way, he was almost double his size when he started on Gokee. He could not run 300 meters. Forget 300, 30 meters. Today, he does ultra marathons. He does full marathons. But we did not know this. He is the head of the CIO Association of India. And he's also the CIO of one of the big multinational corporations. And he became one of our biggest advocates. So without us telling anybody, automatically he gave it to all the top CIOs of the country. And this was another way of how word of mouth played in. So when you have your customers, you don't know who these people are. And at times, they can either become very big viral agents for you, or at times they can become the biggest. I mean, because of him, it could have also been the completely worst, where now none of the CIOs would have ever wanted to get Gokee. But today, in the CIO community, we are very, very popular because we have one of their champions in there. We have Bela Gupta, who was very diabetic. And again, she had huge challenges around her health. And when she came on our platform, we were able to completely reverse it. So she actually started being an entrepreneur in the textile industry. And now, after being with Gokee and getting inspired, she has actually launched her own startup on health food. It's called Herbivore. So the question, and we are supporting her now as a company. And here we have Rahul. Rahul is again an entrepreneur, and he had the challenge of sleep apnea, because of which he had a lot of challenges in health and so on. Last year, we trained Rahul, and he became one of the first people with sleep apnea to trek with us all the way to Everest Base Camp. And that is the story which is now not only being carried by these people, but they are now become, we have a word for them. We call them titans. So these are what we call Gokee titans, and we have almost 25 of them who have their own stories, but they all are almost like our brand, our board of advisors are coming from them. And these are our users. The second thing what we did was we focused on what we call creating tribes, wherein people, or small groups of people who come together in various cities to do events and activities together, who identify themselves. And this was one of our biggest marketing spends in a way. But what we saw was that there is a global trend going on. In fact, you should look this up. It's called Instagrammable fitness. Today, everybody wants to be on Instagram, but they want to show they're doing themselves something cool. And by the way, fitness and health-related posts are number one. So our entire strategy was that how can we give you those moments of Instagrammable fitness? So all our activities are designed around giving you that Instagrammable moment. So when people come to our events, we have special booths, we have photographers, we have social media teams, but the focus is giving you the Instagrammable moment. In fact, tomorrow in Juhu Beach, we are having a big event which is hosted by a YouTube celebrity. This guy is called Beer Biceps. He has one of the most popular fitness channels on YouTube called Beer Biceps, because his concept is you should be able to drink beer and also be able to be healthy at the same time. So Beer Biceps, he's so big, he's only 22 years old. He has a following of lakhs of people now. And he is so big that he is now hosting a session for us where people have been invited. So because now here is this tribe of people who are wanting to associate with this. So the question really for us was, who was our brand ambassador? And I think the best answer for us was, when we asked our users, people